Thank you. Welcome everyone to this place of worship where back in earlier days Alison brought her children to church and Sunday school. Today we gather to celebrate and give thanks to God for the life of Alison Glenda Volk. In doing so, We express our love and concern for the family and those closest to her. We're reminded by the words of Scripture that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is God's faithfulness. And the words of Jesus, blessed are they that mourn, for they will be comforted. Let's join in prayer. Eternal God, our Creator and Redeemer, in the face of death, we gather together to celebrate the gift of Alison's life and to thank you for what she has meant to each one here. We open our hearts to you and to one another. May your life-giving spirit flow through us, filling us with compassion one for another. Grant us your love and peace as we reach out to comfort each other. We confess that we have not always lived as you want us to. We have not loved as Christ loved us. Father, forgive us if there have been times when we failed, Alison, and enable us by your grace to forgive anything that was hurtful to us. Lord, by your mercy, set us free from our sins and grant us healing and wholeness. And help us, God, as we face the mystery of death, to believe in the resurrection to life everlasting, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Alison's niece Philippa and nephew Warwick will bring to us a musical tribute.
Dreams are calling true.
Today, the eulogy and tributes are brought by family and friends. Firstly, Erin will bring to us the eulogy, and this will be followed by Alison's friend Mari, and then Philippa will read some messages from others.
Thanks, guys. That was really great. Well done. Today, we are honouring, celebrating and remembering Alison, our mum. She was also a much-loved daughter, sister, niece, cousin and friend to so many. She was a woman of kindness and courage with a stubborn streak to rival the best. Alison was born in Mafra on the 14th of January 1954 to proud parents Herbert and Alice. She was second born to brother Barry and younger sister Raylene. Then came Christopher, who sadly passed away at an early age of 6 weeks. Her first years were spent in Myrtlebank on a dairy farm. Due to her father's farm work, the family moved to the Brownlow family farm at Forge Creek, just out of Bairnsdale. The family then moved into Gould Street to access schooling at Bairnsdale West Primary. At the age of 2 years, she was involved in an incident where she fell into the water trough. Luckily rescued by brother Barry, however, later suffered from pneumonia where she spent a considerable amount of time in hospital. Her childhood activities included a lot of horse riding. This involved a long ride by the three kids to the pony club grounds just to enjoy a day of riding or competing and then ride the long journey home. Mum was an exceptional student and because of this, she skipped grade 3. She said it was a hard transition as she left her friends behind and had to make new ones. High school was next, at where she attended Bairnsdale Tech School and where she completed a traineeship in stenography, which for people who don't know is typing. After completing this qualification, she left school at the age of 15 to pursue her career as a personal assistant to the town of Bairnsdale's council's town clerk. Alison worked in this role for 11 years, making a lot of lifelong friends along the way, many of whom are here with us today. This was a great social atmosphere with many memorable nights, partying and family get-togethers. One thing you may not know about Alison was her first form of transport was a motorbike, a Yamaha 70. Her wild side came to a grinding halt when she got hit by a car. Luckily, no injuries were sustained, but from this, she lost her confidence. The famous blue Datsun 120B was the next form of transport, commonly known as the blue bomb to us kids, as us kids would call it. We remember despising it, as it would often break down on the way to school. One particular day, it broke down going up the steep hill to Granny's house, and we all had to get out and roll it back down the hill. Mum must have loved it though, she couldn't part with it despite many offers of people wanting to buy it. As most of Ali's prized possessions, the motorbike and the blue bomb still graze at her property today. Alison enjoyed ballroom dancing and was successful in competition. During this stage of her life, she met Wayne at one of the dance halls and from there they were married and built their first home in Hatfield Street. Along came three children, Rachel, Paul and Erin. In these years, she was a stay-at-home mum with a casual job at a local cafe and also Warren Graham and Murphy. From there, mum's next job was at the Bairnsdale Hospital in 1994. She worked there for 28 years as a receptionist to the emergency department and the main reception, up until she was no longer able to continue working because of her health. Although the work was tough and draining at times, she never let it get her down, which is a testament to how tough she was. We are sure her favourite part of all those years working there would be the many wonderful people she worked alongside. Some have become Mum's closest friends of whom she loved and cherished dearly and would often come home with a funny story of jokes had with security guards and the shenanigans that went on to pass the time and deal with the interesting situations that would arise. A lot of the staff Mum worked alongside during her time at BRHS were there to care and nurse her in her recent stays in the emergency department and on the wards. It brought her great comfort to know who was looking after her and the exceptional kindness and care she received in her final days. This was greatly appreciated by us all and will never be forgotten. The family purchased a piece of land out near her parents' place on Oliver's Road, and she made it her own with her beloved plants and trees galore. She loved the native birds and animals, and right up to the end, she was always reminding us to buy some bird seed and put it out into her feeder. Her love of animals started at a young age and included cats, dogs, horses, alpacas, roosters, chooks, birds, and many more, but her favourite was her beloved wombat, Wombie. As a kid, she raised Wombie from a baby, and when Wombie got older, it would get under their house in Gould Street and dig, keeping everyone awake at night. She would be out at all hours calling, "Wombie, Wombie," trying to coax her out. Wombie eventually went to live at a wildlife sanctuary in Swan Hill. Any animals that came to live at the farm, and there were a lot, never left there until the end of their days. We called it the retirement farm. It was the family pet cemetery, and that's the way she wanted it. There were many fun family memories created by going camping with the Newton family to the Buchan Caves, Lake Sentrance, and Cape Conron. Later came weekends away camping with the horses and with close family friends, the Hanley family, whilst us kids competed in many horse events all over the countryside. Alison's 7 grandchildren meant the world to her, and there was much excitement for each of their arrivals. Millie was first and the only granddaughter, then came grandsons, Wiley, Jack, Brady, Ollie, Riley and Coden. There would always be a handmade item of some sort for the new baby, boots, beanies, blankets, all made with so much love and pride. There were always a treat to be found at Nan's place and often a coffee date with baby chinos or milkshakes, especially with Kathleen of a morning. How lucky they are to have had you in their lives, and they will all miss you dearly. Alison had a very strong bond with her siblings and most of all, dear sister Raz. Raz was her ride or die, and there were many adventures together. It was a great privilege for Mum to care for Raz during her illness and sad passing, and she missed her dearly. Her brother, Uncle Baz, coming to our home and bringing the Bundy rum meant there was always some shenanigans of some sort. Mum loved anything crafty. There were many hobbies over the years, knitting, crochet, sewing, patchwork, cake decorating, needlework, just to name a few. Patchwork became a strong passion, and her collection of fabrics, magazines and patterns is something to behold. A wonderful group of fellow patchworkers became some of Mum's most treasured friends, and they would meet regularly at Mum's house for sewing days. We aren't actually sure how much sewing ever got done, but Mum enjoyed the special friendships, lunches and laughs they shared. We were all lucky to receive a quilt each handmade by Mum, hours and hours of love poured into each one, and such a treasured gift to remember her by, and on display as you entered the foyer. Her roasts, yo-yos, butterfly cakes, and chicken and veggie soup were some of the best. We will never be able to make them with the same amount of love or salt that she did, but we will try. Every birthday, Mum would hand us the Woman's Weekly birthday cake book and let us choose whatever cake our heart desired. It didn't matter how complicated or time-consuming it was, she was always happy to make it. We received countless calls, messages, flowers, meals, and so much love and support from so many wonderful people. They have all been beautiful reminders of the impact Mum had on so many. Alison was a truly exceptional woman. Kind, loyal and so giving. She was always there with love and guidance through the highs and lows of our lives. In her final days, she was still as sharp as a tack. One time, Erin went to the toilet and Paul suggested to Millie it would be funny to lock her in there. This suggestion was met sternly with a "don't you dare" from Mum. As hard as it was to see you in that state, it was a pleasure to be there for you, reminisce on memories and have a final Shivers whiskey and coke with you that we smuggled into the hospital on your last day earthside with us. Now that you are reunited with the rest of the Sawyer family, we know you are at peace and pain-free. To all of Mum's wonderful friends who have gone above and beyond to support and care for her and us in so many ways during the last few months, we thank you. We know Mum was forever grateful to you all. Gone but not forgotten.
Hello, I'm Alison's cousin. Our granny Soria had five perfect grandchildren. I was the eldest, and Alison was the second youngest. And we kept the family tradition going. Alison had seven perfect grandchildren, and I had six. Alison's grandkids, all six boys and one girl, will have special memories of their nan. She kept the biggest lolly jar you ever saw. And if you were good, you had two choices. If you were just normal, you got two anyway. Also, they will remember Nan's special chicken soup. It cured everything, especially for a bad cough or a bruised knee. Alison was a great handicraft person. She knitted, she crocheted beautifully, and made patchwork quilts. Her work was so neat, and she always aimed for perfection. That's why some of her projects took a long time. I remember a half-made quilt hanging on the curtain for at least a couple of years. Alison loved all creatures, big or small, and if any animal came to her farm, they never left. They were never sold, they were never killed. She fed the birds, and the wild ducks were very safe in her pond. While she was very ill, some little birds nested in a rose bush on the veranda. It was very windy. And she got up, and the birds were having a hard time. She got up and tied the bush to the post and put some plastic over it. Well, the little bird said it was so good that they come back and had a second lot of chicks there. Didn't look very good, but Alison didn't care. Alison's phobias made it extremely difficult for her at times, but she did her best she could with the help from her understanding family and devoted family. Alison was so grateful to her three children, Rachel, Paul and Erin, for their care during her very debilitating illness. She told me many times how good they were to her and how they enabled her to stay at home as long as she did. Alison, I was so lucky to have you as my cousin and my friend. I'm going to miss our weekly phone calls and miss you. Rest in peace.
Extended family. Alison was a valued member of our family. Her devotion to her own family has been evident for many years. We wish to acknowledge the selflessness of Rachel, Paul and Erin and their families over the past few months, giving the utmost care above and beyond most people's capabilities. Alison was a proud mother and nan who will no doubt be watching over all of you. We will miss you, Alison. You will always be in our hearts. This is from one of Alison's old school friends, Heather Fallon, previously Thicket. I have known Alison for most of my life. We first met when I started at Bairnsdale High School in about 1965. There were four of us, then Merrill, Bev, Alison and me, and we got around together at school until I left in 1969. I started a job in Yarram after about a year. Once I had my license, came home every weekend, spending lots of time at Alison's place. One time, Al came to my mum's place with a new scooter, just for her license. We all had a ride. Lots of fun. Another time, Alison, Raylene and myself went out to a farm. They were going to teach me to ride. We laughed so much. I was hopeless. I did learn to ride years later. When Bev was married, Al and I were bridesmaids. Then I was married. Al and Bev were my bridesmaids. Then it was Alison's turn. She had three lovely babies. I used to visit them from time to time as her family grew. We always sent Christmas cards for many years. Our lives were busy. I had a business and was on a farm. I finally had a daughter. She was so pleased for me. The years have flown by. I used to go to cattle sales in Bairnsdale. I'd call into the hospital for a chat, or we'd have a cuppa down the street. Didn't see each other for a while, then caught up, realised we were both on our own. We would sometimes meet up at craft days in Bairnsdale and sale. I have very fond memories of Alison. She always talked about her family, looking after her grandchildren. It's a shock to hear she has gone. Last time, not long before Christmas, John and I came back through Bairnsdale late in the afternoon. I thought we would catch up later. So sorry now I didn't stop. My brother, David Thicket, sends his sincere condolences to your family. He has special memories. He was her partner when she did her deb. I think she was about 21. I will miss her giggle and smiling face. When we caught up, it was like we were never apart. Rest in peace, my dear friend. This is from Kathy Downey and Alison Reddick. We had the absolute pleasure of knowing Alison for nearly 14 years. We both met Ali working in the Bairnsdale Hospital reception area and went from being work colleagues to close friends. Alison was always great to work with and was willing to listen when you needed to vent. If you had a problem, she had some great advice, but only if you asked her for her thoughts on it. She was quick to have a laugh, and we had lots of those over the years, especially on our nights out. We will hold on to the memories we all made together and are going to miss our dinner and movie nights and just the simple pleasures of Alison's company. She was a true friend to both of us, and that is something we will treasure forever. We will miss you, Alison. Rest easy now, my dear friend. Alison and Kathy. And this is from Alison's cousin, Debbie. For a number of years, Alison and I have shared many a coffee, leading into lunch, followed by plenty of shopping adventures. She has inspired me to tackle quilting projects and shared her vast knowledge and hints along the way. Nearly every shopping adventure finished at Spotlight, with both of us walking out with an armful of ideas, materials that we had just had to have to complete our stashes. We both admitted to having a problem with regards to our crafting, easily starting a project but not quite finishing one before starting another. UFI's unfinished items stacking up, but we promised each other to mend our ways. On many occasions, she has helped me through difficult situations that have occurred. A couple of pieces of advice that we would quote to each other were to get all your ducks in a row and not to overthink things. She was not only my cousin, but my friend and confidant. Rest in peace, Alison. Love from Deb.
Some wonderful tributes to Alison. Is there anyone else who would like to come and be briefly here, please?
For those who don't know me, my name's Trevor Newton, and I was very fortunate to work with Alison for a number of years. When I first arrived in Bairnsdale in 1975, Alison was the town clerk's stenographer and a very competent person for taking shorthand and typing. Back in the days when we couldn't easily correct before the digital age, and everything had to be done on a stencil and then run off on a duplicator. And but the correction process was was red nail polished looking stuff for any corrections. And of course today with computers it's much easier for stenographers and typists these days. There's no photocopiers or such like, and Alison was responsible for preparing the agendas and council minutes for the town of Bairnsdale at that time. And she would, when they were completed, she not only finished collating them and all that, she'd even get in the little red bus and go and deliver them as well in many cases. She was I must admit, I have difficulty comprehending shorthand, but she was very good at that. I should not. I was responsible attending council meetings to do the minutes, and it was very messy scribble, I must admit, but she made into something quite legible on the typewriter. She was a very loyal employee and maintained strict confidentiality of council affairs for somebody in that position, highly respected by councillors and staff. Position she held up until she gave birth to Rachel when she left the council at that stage. She had a great sense of humour and enjoyed a good joke, as had been mentioned by Erin before, and that stayed with her for the rest of her life. One of the town clerks, Greg, also enjoyed a joke, and he would tell a joke in between dictating a letter or some reports or something, just to break up the monotony of her typing. On many occasions, whilst Alison was bashing away at the typewriter, she burst out laughing. And we knew what that was from, because Greg had given her a couple of jokes. I'm not sure that some of those jokes today would be accepted by today's protocols, but that was the life then. I later had the pleasure to work with Alison again at the Shire of Bairnsdale when I came back to Bairnsdale, and we were looking for reliable staff. And of course, the first person that came to my mind was Alison, because she was so trustworthy and efficient and reliable. We became very close friends. In coming to Bairnsdale, we hadn't lived here before, and that was in 1975, and we made lots of friends with the staff at the town of Bairnsdale, which we've kept in contact with a long time, particularly with Alison Wayne. At that stage, we had an active social club, and many of the staff, at that stage, were young. Many didn't have family, and we had frequent progressive dinners and social occasions, and probably lots of sore heads the next day. It was a great time, and Alison Wayne got married about the same time we moved to Yarram for 6 years. We kept up their friendship during that time. They visited us going to places like Port Albert, Wilson's Promontory, and we also had a place to stay when we came back to Bairnsdale weekends. We were honoured to be invited to be Rachel's godparents to such a lovely, lovely family. We moved back to Bairnsdale in 1986 to take up a senior position at the Shire of Bairnsdale before it got amalgamated New Gippsland Shire. At that stage, we had two children, Tanya 3 and Luke 2, similar ages to Rach, Paul and Erin. And our previous friendship was further consolidated. We enjoyed family barbecues, weekends, camping trips and all that such like that we did. Watching Alison and Wayne, one of the things that come back to memory was at the Buckham Caves, and I think the first time we went there, watching Alison and Wayne erect a tent they'd borrowed from Ellie's sister, Raz. I think it was the same time also when the kookaburra took a hamburger out of my mouth as I was trying to make a barbecue tea. Paul also got into a boxing match with a kangaroo. I think the kangaroo. So, Alison was a very close friend of my late wife, Marilyn. Our children attended Lucknow School together, and both mums were actively involved in the school community. Not sure what else they got up to, but they spent a lot of time helping to entertain the kids together. Alison was a great support to me and the kids after Marilyn passed away in 2001. Alison and Wayne came to the rescue at a moment's notice when Marilyn collapsed in Melbourne and dropped everything to bring Tanya and Luke to Melbourne for us. Everyone is well aware of Alison's love of animals and a huge reluctance to part with any of them, regardless of the circumstances. And one of the stories that I remember is the wombat that lived under the parents' house in Gould Street. She was a loving mother to Rachel, Paul and Erin, and was a huge influence and support to their adulthood. She helped Rachel in operating the beautiful florist shop in Bailey Street when she started that off. As time passed and family circumstances changed, children leaving school, moving away, Wayne and Alison going their own separate way, and friendships changed. We were always in the background and the bond was still strong. We all managed to see her in hospital at Christmas when my family were in Bairnsdale. We will miss Alison, have great memories of a loving, loyal friend who would be there for us whenever needed, a quality that she passed on to the next generation. Rest in peace, you'll sadly miss by the Newton family.
Hello, my name is Bev, not Bev previously mentioned. This is a message from Izzy, who is unable to be with us today to say farewell to her friend Alison. I first made Alison's acquaintance at the hospital where we both worked. You could always rely on a warm smile from Alison to start the shift. It wasn't until Alison came to me for Bowen therapy that our friendship blossomed. She was so supportive and encouraging of my new venture. With her many recommendations, I eventually met all of her lovely family. Alison and I laughed our way through ups and downs. She was always ready with a smile and chuckle, no matter what adversity she was dealing with. She shared with us her interests in gardening, reading, patchwork, and her love of animals and bird life. Alison especially encouraged love and appreciation of nature in her grandchildren. I am honoured to call Alison a friend. Dear friend, rest in peace. Love, Izzy. Now this next one's from me, and I'm sorry it's going to be a bit repetitive. And if I stumble, I've just discovered from a mourner here today that Alison and I were distantly related, a fact I never knew. Alison and I both attended Bairnsdale High School. We were not friends, but crossed paths in occasional classes or at the canteen. We shared a lot of food, not school. Our next encounter was at the Royal Bairnsdale Hospital quite a few years ago. When we entered the front door, especially in the afternoon or weekends, Alison's smile and greeting met us. Sometimes we were able to have a quick chat. If staff needed to contact reception for assistance, Alison was always obliging, eager and willing to help out. Day after day, week after week, she toiled, always with a smile and a cheerful word for all, despite any trials and tribulations she was facing in her private life. Devoting as much time as possible to her beloved sister Raylene and dealing with her own medical battles. Many months ago, I was approached by Ellie in the local chemist. She had changed since I saw her, but she was still smiling and jovial. We sat on the chairs and we chatted for an eternity while she waited for her medication package. I offered to do anything I could to help her. Just give me a call. We had occasional meetups for coffee and treats at local eateries. Pink jelly cakes and cream, Ruth and Bakery Cornish pasties were go-tos. A few trips to Traralgon for appointments entailed snacks and coffee at Momo. Arancini balls were our favourites, and a browse in Harris scarf before they opened in Bairnsdale. Over the past few months, we kept each other company, always talking, doing crosswords. Ellie knew the answers to all the hard clues. We enjoyed the wildlife on her property, a variety of birds, butterflies, and the resident hare who occasionally hopped across the yard, and remember the woolly wagtails nesting in the rose bush. Alison always asked what was happening in the life of her visitors and was interested in their families. Speaking of family, she loved and cherished Rachel, Paul, and Erin, and her grandkids. Not a day went by when they weren't in conversations. She was so proud of them all. Ellie looked forward to their visits, and from Philippa and her children, she was always interested in their activities and sporting achievements. Alison's condition continued to deteriorate, but she was stoic and accepted each day as it dawned. She was in control and had a mind of her own. Christmas approached and Christmas pudding was on the menu. Out came the recipes and she supervised the girls in the production. New Year's Eve came and went. then the big birthday bash. She never looked happier than being with friends and family. She enjoyed her perfect day. Easter was low key, but treats were distributed to the grandchildren as usual. Alison showed us that family always comes first. She was proud of her family who loved her. Sadly, Alison is no longer with us, but she will always be fondly remembered.
Is there anyone else who'd like to share? I invite you to sit with your own memories as the photo presentation goes up.
Supermarket flies from the windowsill, through the day old tea from the cup. Packed up the photo album Matthew had made, memories of a life that's been long. Took the Garrett Wilson cars and stuffed animal, put the old ginger beer down the sink. Dad always told me, don't you cry when you're down, but Mum, there's a tear every time. Spring. stack the chairs up. Folded your nightgowns neatly in a cape. John said he'd drive them, put his hand on my cheek, and wiped a tear from the side of my face. Now that I see the world as you did, 'cause I know a life without is a life that's been lived, so I'll sing hallelujah.
The words of the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I need nothing more. You give me rest in green meadows, setting me near calm waters, where you revive my spirit. You guide me along sure paths. You are true to your name. Though I should walk in death's dark valley, I fear no evil with you by my side. Your shepherd's staff to comfort me. You spread a table before me as my foes look on. You soothe my head with oil. My cup is more than full. Goodness and love will tend me every day of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live. The words of this psalm were written by King David at the end of a lifetime of trust in God. A lifetime where he'd faced difficulties, hardships, and his own failings. And he's reflecting back on life with a sense of a deep communion with God. God is the one who provides for us in life. And David testifies to God who sustained and strengthened him and led in the way he sought to live his life. This sense of joy and well-being as David reflects on God's leading, leading to green pastures and beside quiet streams, refreshing and restoring his innermost being. I didn't know Alison until the last week of her life, when I was privileged to have spent some time with her. Alison wasn't much of a churchgoer, particularly in later years, and perhaps the things of faith were not something she readily understood. But in my conversation with her, she shared a sense of something more than the life we can see and touch. As I spoke with her, I shared with her how I believed that God's love was always there for her, whether she recognised it or not, and that it was never too late to reach out to God. Death is largely a mystery to us. It's a going into the unknown. Some of you may not be sure that there's anything beyond death. As Christians, we believe that as we journey between life and death, we are safe in the hands of an infinitely gracious God. The last week of Alison's life included Good Friday and Easter Sunday. This is the time when, as Christians, we remember that the God who stands with us at the moment of death is the same God who in Jesus was prepared to die in love for all humankind, a God who entered into every struggle of our life with us and who deeply understands us. In Jesus, his life, death and resurrection, we come to see that in all things God is for us and not against us, even when we don't always recognise it or respond to it. I believe that Jesus died for Alison, as with each one of us. More than that, he rose again, saying, "Because I live, you will live also." I believe that God was there for Alison as she walked through the path of death into the life eternal. For David, the blessing of close association with God comes particularly evident in times of distress and danger. Even through the difficult times, God had not forsaken him. God had been his guide, his refuge, and his comfort. And I believe that God provides for us as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and that God is here for us as we come to grips with our physical separation from those we love. And so it is today we give thanks for the life of Alison, and we seek God's comfort in the sense of loss and God's presence and strength for our own living. May you know God as your shepherd in life, leading you to places of calm and refreshment, and God's help in the tough times and amidst the complexities of life. Let us join in a time of prayer. Creator, living God, we give thanks for the many ways in which Alison shared her life with others, her family, her friends, through her work at the hospital and the Shire. We thank you for acts of kindness and generosity, and the tenacity and determination she showed in the face of difficulties. We thank you for her creative gifts that brought joy, not just to her, but to others. We thank you, God, for the way that Alison loved and cared for family members in their time of need, and for family who loved and cared for her, especially supporting her through the last period of ill health. And while we thank you for the years of Alison's presence among us, we also thank you that she no longer has to suffer pain or illness, and that for Alison the limitations and difficulties of this world are ended. We pray for the family gathered here who have known Alison as mother and grandmother, as cousin, or in other ways, especially remembering Rachel and Paul and Aaron and their families. Surround them and all who mourn today with your loving presence and help them to emerge from these days looking ahead with courage and hope, and walking by faith in the light of your love. We thank you for the bonds that hold us together and support us, even while we feel the pain of separation, and help us to keep on supporting one another. We pray for others living with cancer and those who support and care for them. We give thanks to those who work to find cures for cancer and other conditions. May you guide and enable that new discoveries might be found. And we pray for those who are facing their own death in the near future and those who wait with them. May your gift of peace be there for each one. And Lord, help us to learn from Alison's example, to treasure the gifts she has left us, to build on the foundation she has given. Then, Lord, in your good time, reunite us with her in your everlasting kingdom, where there will be no more tears and no more partings. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In a few moments, we'll stand for the commendation and blessing. At the conclusion of the service, I invite you to follow the family out as the as Alison's body is taken to be cremated. And then at the end of the service, that you're invited to join with the family at the East Club, the one across the road, the other side of the roundabout, not at the family home as in the order of service, but just across the road in the club there. Please stand. As we go from this place, we can then commend both Alison and ourselves to the love and mercy of God. Heavenly Father, by your creative power, you have given us the gift of life. And in your redeeming love, you have given us new life in Jesus Christ. Rejoicing in your gift of eternal life, confident in the love you have for all, we commend Alison into your care. And now that her earthly life has come to an end, we commit her body to the ground, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, trusting in your love and the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Nothing in all of life or death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And as you go, may God the Father make you holy in his love, God the Son enrich you with his grace, God the Holy Spirit strengthen you with joy. The Lord bless you and keep you in eternal life.
There you go.
Go there.